At this time, I'm going to ask for Dr. David Lose, the president of Lutheran Theological Seminary at Philadelphia, to come back, to welcome, not come back, but come back, come forward. Come forward, bring greetings and welcome you, and then I will return, introduce our speaker, and we'll be in the hands of Dr. Forbes. I want to say again, thank you for coming. You. Dr. Lose.
Good morning.
Morning.
It is a pleasure and a delight to welcome you here this morning. 35 years ago, the Urban Theological Institute was just a hope. It was just a dream, shared with Dr. Willis and Dr. Jones, with some of the leadership here. And since that time, it has become a mainstay of the life of this school, a force for good in the community, and a place where we've been able to recognize the distinct charism of African-American preaching and theology and share that with the whole church. And it is a joy to be able to gather and celebrate these 35 years, as well as give thanks for the years to come in hope and anticipation. Over the years, we've had a number of wonderful speakers for this lectureship. When you read the list of names, you can see that we have been blessed beyond measure and deserving. This year is no exception. It falls to Dr. Q, not myself, to introduce our speaker. But I will say, Dr. Forbes, I've run into two colleagues who have referenced hearing you before, and each could quote lines from the sermon or the lecture you gave, which I think is pretty impressive. So we are grateful for your presence here, and we are grateful for all of you. And so I say welcome in the name of Jesus Christ. Know you are a gift and a blessing to us, even as we pray that this school is a gift and blessing to the church and the world God loves so much. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Dr. Lose. If for some reason you need to leave early, there will be a basket in the back if you want to make a contribution. And I do want to invite you on this evening. We know that many times that our lectures turn into sermons, and the way you respond to Dr. Forbes, it could convert in the middle. However, he is lecturing today and preaching this evening. And so I invite you at 7 p.m. to meet us at Enon Tabernacle Baptist Church, where our co-chair for the 35th anniversary, Dr. Alan Iwala, serves as pastor for that evening worship experience, and you'll get to hear Dr. Forbes preach. His wife is with him. I will let him introduce the sugar in his tea and the milk in his coffee. I learned that from you, Dr. Forbes. I do not want to offend you by reading his bio that is printed, just a brief bio in the bulletin. I like to make a personal connection. Dr. Forbes has been a hero since I was a teenager. And the reason that is because Dr. Forbes comes out of the Holiness Pentecostal tradition. He's ordained American Baptist, but his roots is United Holy Church of America, which was established actually before the Church of God in Christ. Church of God in Christ beats it only in incorporation. And so one who has been ordained in the Church of God in Christ, who is serving in the Baptist Church and now has ordination in the Baptist Church like you, Dr. Forbes, and we both share Howard University in common. He beat me by a year or two. And so I recall when I was interning, I believe the year was 1990, in Minneapolis, Minnesota, at Pillsbury, working on my MBA. And on the cover of the Wall Street Journal was Jim Forbes, the pastor of the Riverside Church in New York City. And so he was already a hero, but that just took it a notch up for me. He has endeared himself, and he is now a friend, and he is a mentor. And so it is a great honor for me to introduce and welcome, for the 35th anniversary, our guest lecturer, Dr. James A. Forbes, Jr. Receive him now.
Thank you. So glad I'm here. So glad I'm here. So glad I'm here in Jesus' name. So glad I'm here. So glad I'm here. So glad I'm here in Jesus' name.
President Lowe's, Dr. Robertson, members of the board and faculty, student body of Lutheran Theological Seminary, colleagues in ministry from the city, all brothers and sisters beloved. I am glad I'm here. That is because, number one, I do feel at home. You have included me in your history over the years so that I do not come as a stranger, but one continuing of friendship over the years, and I value our association. I also want to say a special word to the Lutheran community. When I was in Africa, and in South Africa particularly, I was convinced, as people described the various organizations that were contributing to their aspiration for freedom, that the Lutheran Church worldwide has most consistently served the cause of justice in difficult places, and I'm very honored to be a part of that tradition. Urban Ministries has been a part of my beat, as it were, because where Dr. Robertson is, I go up just to, as it were, defend myself against anything that he's doing, because I'm implicated with whatever he's doing. So I say yes anytime he invites me to come. Now today, I feel that this is such a historic moment. Two things. One, the coming of the Pope here, very significant. And in Washington today, be with you, then be with us in New York City. It is interesting to see how the Lord can pick up a person and use a person without respect to his background or her background to capture the imagination of the people. And he has managed in some way to represent his own tradition, but to bring a breath of fresh air. And I think that God is at work in the work that he is doing, and I'm happy to be a part of that. He comes, however, at a time when there is heightened concern about our life together as people beyond consideration of our ethnic background. Delighted to come here and notice the t-shirts outside as a reflection of this community's awareness of the crisis in our communities all across this nation in regards to police community relations and in regards to particularly black young people, black and Latino youth, et cetera. These are very, very difficult times. Difficult, yes. But thank God we are beginning to have conversation. My wife always captures what's on TV. I mean, CBS, somebody calls, did you check what they're doing? PBS, yesterday, Gwen Ifill was on with a report reflecting with some of the people in Charleston, South Carolina, after the massacre and Mother AME, you know, Emmanuel AME. And then before that, who else you put on with me, Betty? Steve Harvey, a major program on the conversation about race, I just recently, Sunday, was in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, where I had my first ministry opportunity 53 years ago. I was brought there by the Student Interracial Ministries. So it looks like it is true that we had better get ready for action, because as the scripture tells us, it was David after he had become king and was to go out and to fight against the Philistines, and that he inquired, shall I go? And on one occasion, yes, go, and he was successful. Second time he asked, is there no wait? There are some instructions. Sometimes you have to wait for the right time to advance. And so he waited, and the word was, now here's the sign. When you hear stirrings in the top of the mulberry bushes, then you go forth, for it is clear then that the Lord goes forth before you. I hear stirrings in the top of the mulberry trees, suggesting it's time for action. And so I am here today in the spirit of that text, saying, I hope that what we say here in the morning and even in the evening will help get us ready for advancing in a serious way to hear the assignment and to be ready to embrace it. What I am going to lecture about today, whenever I have preached this particular sermon, I have entitled it a fresh anointment for a new appointment. But I'm going to give it a different title since I'm lecturing. I want to speak to you from 1 Kings chapter 19, and I'm going to read verses 11 through 16. And the title for today is Spiritual Empowerment for the Transformation of Our Nation. The voice said, go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Now there was a great wind, so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? He answered, I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away. Then the Lord said to him, go. Return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram. Also, you shall anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel. And you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah, as prophet in your place. Here ends the reading from God's holy word, and to God's name be all glory and praise. Some of you recall that it was in 2007 that I retired from my 18 years stint as the senior minister at the Riverside Church. Amen. Following that time, it was important to me. I wasn't run out of the church, really. I was led by the Spirit that it was time to kind of close down that ministry. And I thought I needed some rest from the rigor of that engagement. I told Jesse Jackson I was going to, you know, I was going to get a little R&R. Jesse Jackson said, well, R&R is all right as long as you don't overdose on it. So after a while, I took up the role of working with the Healing of the Nations Foundation out of the book of Revelation. There should be a tree bringing forth its fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nation. And I got the impression that each human being is a leaf from the tree of life. And having had some exposure to botany, was very familiar with the process of photosynthesis, whereby the leaf of the tree actually manufactures the food that's necessary for the plant. It does so first by drawing water and minerals out of the earth, and then drawing carbon dioxide out of the air, and with the catalytic enzyme of chlorophyll and the sun providing the energy for the chemical process, by the process of photosynthesis, the food necessary for the plant was provided. Of course, fascinating thing to me was that the byproduct of photosynthesis, drawing carbon dioxide out of the air, a toxic presence, a contaminant in the air, that the result of the transformation in the process of photosynthesis was that the plant produced, almost as a byproduct, oxygen, which I viewed as a healing element. Thereby, it came clear to me that each human being who is a leaf on the tree of life needs to be productive, at least in regards to one's own self, that one ought to be healthy. One ought to be conscientious about one's own health in body, mind, spirit, and emotions, relationships, vocations, your community engagement, that we should seek to be as healthy and whole as we can possibly be. But if we are healthy, one of the byproducts will be that in the natural course of ministering to our own health, we will inadvertently find ourselves engaged in healing. Yeah. Production of the oxygen that serves as healing. So to be conscientious, to be a good leaf, is you are healthy yourself, but you are a channel of God's healing grace. And that's so I worked with that for a while. And then Union Seminary invited me across the street to become the Harry Emerson Fosdick Distinguished Professor. So I did that for a while. But my most recent requirement has been to agree to join with Martin Luther King III in an organization called the Drum Major Institute, which is attempting to bring to realization the unfinished aspects of the agenda of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And so that's what I am now. And they gave me different titles. I don't want all those titles. I just want to be, at Riverside, I was doing retail business. And then the Lord says, no, I want you to get out and try to help bring about some transformation in the nation. So I asked him to take off chairman and just put national minister for the Drum Major Institute. Of course, that's what I'm going to do anyway. It didn't matter what they put on the job description, you know. So accepting that job, the unfinished agenda of Dr. King, if I were to do so with integrity, at least I need to refresh my mind with respect to what actually was at the heart of Dr. King's effort that I ought to engage myself in. So, I mean, what is it that he was about? Well, since having been at Riverside for 18 years, we did a funny thing at Riverside. Instead of using "I Have a Dream" every year at the birthday celebration, we chose to read from "A Time to Break Silence," the speech that he delivered with clergy and laity concerned about Vietnam, that he delivered 1 year to the date of his assassination, April 4th, 1967. And the Lord, I think actually the Lord led me. You want to understand about Dr. King and what the contemporary continuation would look like, I will show it to you. And Lord knows it was shown to me. I read that speech. I'd heard it many, many, many times. Every year we'd read that. But this time, under the leading of the Spirit, a major discovery. Dr. King, in that speech, given at the Riverside Church, made this statement: "I am convinced that if we are to get on the right side of the world revolution, we as a nation must undergo a radical revolution of values. We must rapidly begin the shift from a thing-oriented society to a person-oriented society." That was nice. I thought, yeah, that's it. Except, as I read the speech, including that first reference to a radical revolution of values, there were seven references in the next two pages that included revolution of values. Another one: "A true revolution of values will soon cause us to question the fairness and justice of many of our past and present policies." Second time. Third time: "A true revolution of values will soon look uneasily on the glaring contrasts of poverty and wealth." A fourth: "A true revolution of values will lay hands on the world order and say of war, this way of settling differences is not just." Five: "America, the richest and most powerful nation in the world, can well lead the way in this revolution of values." Six: "This kind of positive revolution of values is our best defense against communism," and now I add, "and modern terrorism." And seven: "A genuine revolution of values means in the final analysis that our loyalties must become ecumenical rather than sectional. Every nation must now develop an overriding loyalty to mankind, I say humankind as a whole, in order to preserve the best in their individual societies." Can you believe that? Can you believe that Dr. King mentioned seven times in a couple of pages revolution of values? Why is it that the only thing we would hear was, "I have a dream"? Why would we overlook it? I think it may have to do with, number one, the way it was introduced: a radical revolution. That may explain it. Most of us get nervous when there is the mention of something being radical. Or if we say revolution, we get armed struggle and the violent overthrow of one's government. So maybe that's why we prefer, I have a dream. Let's guess what? The dream will never be realized apart from a radical revolution. Which I think is introductory to what I wanted to say. Oh, Betty, I forgot. He said I should introduce you. I always, everybody knows, I introduce my wife every time she's with me. It's an honor to have her. I mean, after all these years, and when I say all these years, we celebrated our golden wedding anniversary last year, 50 years. And all of the men have been saying since that I introduce her, she's the cream in my coffee, the sugar in my tea, the gravy on my grits, and the only fish in my sea. There is no problem in my mind when I talk about radical revolution, or to say of myself that I guess since I've reached my 80th birthday, if I have 80 more years left, I think I could use them all trying to help bring about a radical revolution of values. When Dr. King talks about radical revolutionary, his goals are not overthrow. His goal is transformation. Yeah. Dr. Lowe, I don't know why in the black church, if there's a point that you really want to stick, you say, let everybody say transformation. And sometimes you get the impression that maybe we're not very intelligent because they say, turn to your neighbor and say, turn to your neighbor. Transformation was Dr. King's goal, and that placed him right at the heart of the prophetic tradition of Israel. Because that is also where Elijah stood. He was sent by God to be a spokesperson in his time. He stood in the heart of the prophetic tradition of Israel. He was instructed to call the people to be faithful to their covenant commitment to Yahweh. A problem, however, they were functioning in the midst of a culture largely responsive to the worship of, we say Baal. My professor Meilenberg used to talk about Baal, but people in my church didn't seem to get that, so I went back to Baal. In other words, idolatry was the presenting problematic at that time. He spent the first phase of his ministry confronting Ahab, who was leading the people into idolatrous apostasy. Then the time came after R&R, after a period of depression and despondency under the juniper tree, the broom tree, so depressed, now lettest thy servant just die, for I'm not greater than my elders. After that little breakdown, I guess you hate to say it because religious leaders ought not to have breakdown. When he was through with that, the Lord summoned him to Mount Horeb. Why, Lord? Not just to get you up from having... You know, sometimes you'll get up and go can get up and go. But the Lord invited him for another purpose. It's almost now, in retrospect, that the down moments in our existence and ministries may be like a factory that has to retool to get ready for the contemporary continuation of the business. So those of you who kind of down, they're rewiring the factory, man. They get new equipment in there, and you all up and active and full vigor in your ministry, you get in the way of the changes necessary for the manufacturing necessary for the product that we need right now. Back then, it was fine. Good. We got a new market now.
Yeah.
In the age of globalization, what we used to do might not be quite as effective as we need it to be now.
Yes.
If that, you know, almost like station identification. Well, Lord, if that's the case, all right, I'll accept this low period. I'll accept this malaise of the moment. I'll rest because I don't feel like going out. I mean, things have slowed me down. I will accept it as a part of the Romans 8 plan. God is at work even in the downtime. Prepare us for when we got to get up and go and do what I ask you to do. So there he is, and the Lord promised, I'm coming by. And the text makes it very clear that that the Lord was going to come by. But just as we will not be able to do exactly as we did before, perhaps God, in coming by, will not come by exactly as God has come by before. Well, you can't make me doubt. I know God works in a whirlwind. I know God is with, because when the Red Sea was parted, the wind blew and dried up everything, and they went by. I know God works in the wind, but the text says, but God was not. When you ask Moses, there was a kaboom-a-loom on Mount Horus the first time. Mountain shaking and the rocks falling. So I know God works in an earthquake. Ask Joshua. When the wall had to come tumbling down, there was a kaboom-a-loom. I know God works in the earthquake. And more recently, don't give me ancient history, give me current events. Well, I was up there on Mount Carmel when they prepared the altars and the others were gashing themselves and crying, oh, Baal, oh, Baal. I know that if it's not in the wind, and if it's not in the earthquake, I know it's in the fire. Because the fire fell. Burned up the sacrifice, lift up the water in the churches. So now I know this must be God. But strange. God was not in the fire. And of course, you know the text, it says, but then, as they told me, a still small voice. Except be careful if you go to seminary, and they start teaching you Hebrew, and you start getting entangled with these scholars, and they start interpreting what it really says. I hope there's no disappointment. It really
Not actually, it didn't really say it's still small. Do you know what it said? It said, as a sound of sheer silence, which is almost oxymoron. Which suggests that this was no divine manifestation as earthquake, wind, or fire, or even an encouraging word. What was it this time? Well, whatever it was so necessary for what the brother was called upon to do, that it was different. And I had to debate which one of you to use for this. The fascinating thing was Elijah was not given the word that it had said earlier, the horse said, the word said. This was the sound of silence, which is to say, instead of a manifestation, there was a divine presentation of God's own self. Yeah. Bypassing the tympanic membrane, you don't need a voice to speak to the eardrum. There is in Elijah a soul that knows what it was called to be, a soul that understands what is, why he came out of that area, Tishbe. His soul knows, and the God that made the soul, that very maker of the soul, instead of speaking to the soul, presents itself to the soul. Of that which was in the beginning, that had been imprinted in the image and likeness of this Elijah. The wholeness of which he was a part reconnected itself so that the part is experienced as being a part of the whole.
Yeah.
Oh, that feels mystical to me. That which has made you brings you into its own proximity, overcoming the boundaries. I know we have emblems and transcendent, but when the transcendent almost acts like there is no boundary between the transcendent and the imminent.
Yeah.
Woo! I was looking for an earthquake, but I got the present.
Now the Lord speaks. Because if you can't experience the presence, maybe even the voice will not be compelling. Then the Lord said to him, go. I know you got up and go, had gotten up and gone, but I brought it back now. So go. Return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram, Syria. All you also you shall anoint Jehu as king over Israel, and you shall anoint Elisha in your place. The difference between the last time I was here and now is that you have always done a wonderful job, Elijahs, critiquing and confronting with your finger like Elijah pointing in the face of oppression. Very good. But I have given you a fresh anointment because I have a new appointment. What is it, Lord? Did you hear? Whereas you spent your time critiquing and confronting the king, now I'm calling you to be king and queen makers. Oh.
Yes, sir.
You became experts in hurling your prophetic challenge out there at the powers that be. But I, the God who has brought myself near unto your soul, I am charging you now to be agents of transformation, to create leaders who will help to transform the society. I know we critique what was wrong with it before. That's wonderful. You're experts in your critique, experts in your critique. Now I am training up in Urban Institute ministers who will build systems that may require some excavation of systems as they exist, but it requires constructive, systemic transformation. Turn to your neighbor and say, transformation. If this paradigm makes sense to you, you will be eagerly asking about the parallels to our contemporary situation. Remember now that the presenting problematic was idolatry. So obviously you would wish, Reverend, don't end your talk without saying something about the contemporary idolatries in this nation. Consulting with Dr. King, he lifted up three of them. He called them giants. We call them the giant triplets. Racism, materialism, militarism. And clearly, at least let's start out with one of them, since time is limited. If you want opportunity for question and answer, you will have to let one be central, but not to worry, because even though they are giants, they always hang together. Shall I call it race, or shall I call it bigotry, greed, and violence? Go again. But why don't we just spend before the question and answer time a little bit saying something about race. Because it's in the news. It's in the air. It's on your front lawn there.
Yes.
In my book, Whose Gospel, I have a chapter entitled, Which Gospel Do You Believe About Race? I attempt to describe two kinds of commitments regarding racial attitudes. One I call the gospel of racial exceptionalism. That's just a nice way of speaking about racism, okay? The other is the gospel of human race equality of being. And on Steve Harvey's show, they did a research to figure out where people stood. We fall in either the category that really believes in the gospel of racial exceptionalism, or the gospel of human race equality of being, or we fall in one area between the two with various combinations of the two. And very few of us are going to pass the course unless God is grading on the curve. We interrupt this program for an announcement from the Cosmic Environmental Protection Agency. With this announcement, the pools of ethnic particularity have been polluted by toxic ideologies of supremacy. These pools must be decontaminated if there is to be a prospect for quality human survival. Therefore, beginning immediately, all of the fish in the various pools of ethnic particularity with privileges and pride locked in. All of the fish, black, red, white, brown, and yellow, must be gathered temporarily in a collecting pond while their particularity pool is being contaminated. However, on the basis of preliminary results from the engineers, it is unlikely that the protective pools of privilege based on ethnic particularity can effectively be decontaminated. While you are in the temporary pond, consider that it is likely that the only solution, having moved from the pool of particularity to this waiting pond of collectivity, the only likely solution will to eventually move all of the fish into the ocean of universal humanity in divine love. When you have survived and thrived so well,
come on now,
in your pool,
yes,
of particularity,
yes. Yes.
the invitation into the collective pond is not likely to be a convenient and pleasant place to be. Red fish don't look like white fish. Brown fish don't always look like yellow fish. And black and white fish, they don't look the same. They don't act the same. They don't think the same. They don't even smell the same. They don't even talk the same. And here you all are collected up in this pond. I know it's not convenient, therefore, I might need to give you some advice as to how to survive. But by the way, don't get too comfortable with it, because guess what? It's always most likely that they're going to come to the pond and say, there ain't no other solution but to get into the pond. I'm in a particular precinct you live in, and it's not going to be free from this contamination, because fools do that to you. Fools make you proud that you're not like the other folks. Fools give you privileges that other people don't have. Fools give you the prerogative, the sense of your being a priority in God's own eyes. Fools do that, doesn't matter what you say. They just do that and fall, and if you're not careful, y'all go bust and fight, and you're gonna hire policemen to kill off the other fish. I know this is the time that I'm supposed to get. All right, so let me, while you all are in this collective pond, but don't get settled there too long. I'm going to say this fast. You must learn while you're in that pond to harness the energy of aggrieved entitlement. That's a term I pick up from this book called Angry White Men, from which I want to read just a couple of paragraphs. Brother, it might not be as much time for question and answer, but because I want to read these two paragraphs from this book that a white woman that's a student of mine said, Reverend Forbes, you go preaching, you ought to read this. Because black people rail against these white people for all the mess they're doing. They need to understand a little bit more about what's going on. So, well, this book is about angry white men. I learned something that I did not know. It said, angry white men tell the story of the other side of the American dream. The futility, dashed hopes, despair, and the rage. It tells the story of the rich and famous wannabes, the ones who thought they could invent themselves, reinvent themselves, be even more successful than their fathers. It tells a story of how white American men came to believe that power and authority were what they were entitled to by birth, and how that birthright is now eroding. Economic and social changes that are bewildering, fast, and dramatic are experienced as the general wimpification of American men. Castrated by taxation, crowded out by newcomers who have rules bent for them. White men in America often feel like they are presiding over the destruction of their species. One example, an anguished letter to the editor of a small upstate New York newspaper written in 1993 by an American GI after his return from service in the Gulf War captures some of this sentiment. The letter writer complained that the legacy of the American middle class has been stolen, handed over by an indifferent government to a bunch of ungrateful immigrants and welfare cheats. The American dream, he writes, has all but disappeared, substituted with people struggling just to buy next week's groceries. The letter writer was Timothy McVeigh from McVeigh's father was a union protected worker in the steel plant in Lockport. Tim watched as the plant closed. 2 years later, McVeigh blew up the Murrah
federal building in Oklahoma City in what is now the second worst act of terrorism ever committed on American soil. This is just one example of what happens when history calls us out of the pond, out of the pool of particularity, and the pond of collectivity. They start evening out a bit. Not that they get much better for the poor, but the others begin to experience decline. And that's why some angry folks in this country. That's why folks love to hear politicians act angry and call names. Oh, they love that. Have curled lips. They like that. Because I don't agree with what they said, and they make no sense, but they're expressing how I think. Most folks in the pond feel funny. But meanwhile, before they call us to the ocean, let me tell you now.
Some advice, just some little advice. Y'all in the pond now. Listen. One of the things you can do if you're in the pond to make it a little better is speak to each other. Now, let me explain this. In my apartment, it looked like the white people in there are not so sure that it's safe to say good morning to me. What would happen if we have a hello day in America, where people risk, no matter what color they look like, when you pass and say, good morning. Except I understand some of them don't even say good morning to each other. I thought everybody said good morning when they passed. No, people don't say good morning. I watched them. I was upset because they didn't say good morning to me. They passed by a white man, didn't say good morning to him. Wonder what would happen if all of us red fish, yellow fish, brown fish, red fish, white and black fish would just say good morning. Or more importantly, maybe we have to have conversation with each other. During Lenten season, why don't y'all have in your church conversations across the divide? And make sure that at the have place, make sure that nobody sitting at the table is the same. Create a Mother Emmanuel Bible study where you let somebody that's different than your own ethnicity sit there. It's a risk, I know, but create some safe conversations where we talk about this. Comparative visioning, how things ought to be when compared to the way they are. Some sensitivity training. Sensitize to signs of white supremacy influence, like today. When I bought my sandwich at Kosher, there were five black people. And they served some good sandwiches, y'all, up there in that station. And there was one white woman. Black people all had on hats. The white woman didn't. It was very clear without my even knowing that she was kind of like the supervisor. And I was saying, what's wrong with this picture? I still have. And I ask the same question when I go to New York Philharmonic. And they have one black man playing the double bass in the back, or one black man playing the percussion. Child, we got some good violinists, y'all. Sensitize yourself to asking, why is that difference up there? And then specialize in this. See the pearl in the beauty of diversity. Like giving the Emmy to Viola, the first. Why we got to have so many firsts every day? That ought to be an indictment. Why y'all wait so long to discover that them people, you know, them people can sing. Whether you're black or white, practice random acts of kindness. Yeah. If you're a black person, do something kind to somebody white. Did it. Move from anger management to the mobilization of mood refreshment. Every time you feel your first impulse, say, there it is again, then get a second opinion and make yourself go back and change that into something more human than that. Plan weekly conversations of candor Seek the fish you have not had any exchange with. Play trading places. When you see a white man mad, get in his skin and then wonder what he's mad about. When you see a black man doing something strange, wonder why is he like that. Play some what if. What if you had the power of the loving God? What would you do about the situation? Play proxy for the other. When you get to the accident, it clearly, it was a black man that had run into a white man's car, and the white man is out and he's mad. Instead of simply getting on the black man's side, get in the skin of the white man and wonder how he's feeling. Or vice versa. Educate your aesthetic sensibility. See a model. It's just because she ain't blonde. Check, have you seen some of these wonderful dreads, baby? Doris. Look at your dreads, honey. Look at your dreads. And she left a little silky part to know I could do it if I wanted to do it. I know what you're doing. Encourage risk-taking for justice. And here's the last one, and then I have to close because the time is up. Learn the art of rebuke. When you see something that you know is rooted and grounded in one of these idolatries, learn to rebuke it. Now, let me explain the two phases. First, rebuke it under your breath. Now, if it looks like it could possibly make a difference, open your mouth. That ain't right. But be careful. Be selective. Don't waste your wonderful breath on yelling when it ain't gonna do no good other than to let off a little steam. But learn to rebuke unfairness, especially when you see it in you. Now, let me say this. I tell you, if it were not for the fact that God is calling us to a vocational transformation, I would have spoken at least 10 minutes less and give you a little more time to ask questions or comments. But maybe if you come out to hear the preaching, I may be led by the Spirit to answer the question that you left hanging with now. But in the meantime, remember that the Lord did not send Elijah to this ministry of transformation without first giving the fresh anointment. See if you can spend some time coming to experience that silence, but that definite presence of God in your life. And if that happens, when the call comes, start making kings and queens, starting with my grandchildren and your grandchildren, black boys and white boys and girls, and you're going to make a new system. You may know that the other giants are around. Money will stop you. And if that doesn't do it, violence will do it. But you don't worry about that. So if you've had the visitation of the Spirit in your life, when you get up in the morning, you start out on it, you can do like I do as I close sometimes. I'm going to take heart and get moving, though the clouds hang heavy and gray. If I wait for blue sky perfection, I'll be waiting till judgment day. Why let myself be held hostage, trapped and blocked by who knows what? Will standing still in sinking sand reverse my fate? Certainly not. I'm going to break out and risk living, though the reasons to wait still abound. I will do what I can in the climate of now,
till better days roll around. So take heart, my sisters and brothers, give your spirit a holiday. Away with the reasons, delaying the season, celebration is the order of the day. I really mean it, celebration is the order of the day. Dun, dun, dun.